Ladies and gentlemen, General Peter Pace began his career with the great class of 1967 at the Naval Academy. That makes him my class's 50-year link in the chain. General Pace has held command at all levels, including with 2nd Battalion, 1st Marines, Marine Forces Atlantic, and the U.S. Southern Command. General Pace was sworn in as the 16th Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff on September 30th, 2005. In this capacity, he served as the Principal Military Advisor to the President, the Secretary of Defense, the National Security Council, and the Homeland Security Council. Prior to becoming chairman, he served for 4 years as the vice chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff. General Pace holds the distinction of being the first Marine to have served in either of these positions.
Well, good morning. It's great to be here with you all. I've been asked to talk to you about leadership. And I will talk to you about leadership if you will accept the fact that I do not believe that I'm a leadership expert. I'm going to share biases that I have about leadership that have developed for me over the course of my career and why they're important to me. But before I start, I could not possibly not recognize the incredible folks here from our World War II representatives. Thank you, gentlemen, ladies, for your service to the country. You don't think of yourselves, I'm sure, as heroes. We think of you that way. And for folks like me, it's not that I did not know fear on the battlefield. I certainly did. But that fear was overcome by the fear that somehow I would let down the legacy of the Marines who went before me. And you all, in World War II, set the standard for courage and commitment in all that we hold dear as our traits that we tried to adhere to. So for that, for giving us that to hold on to in the worst of times, thank you very, very much. I should probably get the obvious out of the way. You're looking at my finger. I was defending a little old lady from, actually, that's a story I'd like to tell you. It's simply an infected finger. Leadership principles are standard, but how each individual applies them is very much individual unique. So when you see leaders who you admire, by all means, try to emulate them. And if it works for you, by all means, do it. But if it doesn't work for you, just take it out of your kit bag. For me, I like to touch it. If I could have stood in the hatch and shaken each of your hands as you came in the room, that to me would have been a good thing. It would have made me feel more close to you as a family. I like it when somebody puts their arm around me and says, hey, Pete, you did a good job. I do that with other people. But if you've ever had somebody put their arm around you who is not comfortable doing that, it's kind of like two magnets repelling. You can actually do more damage than good when you do something like that. So emulate the things you like, keep the ones that work for you, leave the other ones on the cutting room floor. You don't need every single leadership trait to be a good leader. It may sound funny to you for a guy who spent 44 years in uniform for me to say, pick where you're going to work. But if you think about it, picking the Army, the Navy, the Marine Corps, the Air Force, Coast Guard, each of those organizations has a unique ethos and personality. The combination gives us a great joint force, but each is very unique. And businesses are unique. With all that's available on the internet right now, why would you not research, whether it's a military job or a civilian job, why would you not do your research on that organization? And especially look at the leaders of that organization. Do you want to grow up and be them? Do you admire them? Do you want to be them? If the answer is yes, by all means, go and chase that route. But the answer is, I don't think I'm very comfortable with whoever it is that you're looking at. You ought to run away. If you are the boss and you parachute in, you might be able to change the culture of the organization. But for most of us who start out at the bottom, the organization changes us. You want to make sure that the organization you join is going to change you into the person you want to be, because it will. Next, and it sounds kind of counter to the first, grow where you are planted. Each of us has in our head exactly what we want to do and how we want to do it right now. But often, our service, our company, has a need that's different from what we'd like to do. And often they will see things in us that we don't see in ourselves necessarily. I could give you example after example after example in my own career. I would simply tell you that had I done everything I wanted to do personally inside the Marine Corps, I'd be retired colonel right now. And don't get me wrong, you make colonel in the United States Marine Corps, you've parted the course. But folks sent me places I did not volunteer to go, and I ended up getting education that I did not know I needed. They gave me the experiences that allowed me to then become a general officer and serve in the joint force. I'll give you just one example. I was a one star. I was serving in Somalia. I got a phone call from General Krulak, who's commandant of the Marine Corps. He says, Pete, I've got some great news for you. You're on the two-star list, and I'm going to give you 1st Marine Division, Camp Pelham, California, when you get home. 16,000 Marines. Southern California. Doesn't get any better. I'm a happy camper. About 3 weeks later, still in Somalia, he calls again and says, Pete, I know I told you that I was going to give you the division, but I want to be able to nominate you for 3 stars, and you don't have a joint tour yet as a general officer. So I'm going to assign you to be the deputy commander of U.S. Force of Japan, and you're going to work for an Air Force officer, and you're going to get your joint credit. Now, this is ego-satisfying, because he's talking about 3, I'm still wearing 1, but it's also disappointing. So I say to the commandant of Marine Corps, sir, if you're asking me if I'd rather go work for some 3-star in Japan and maybe get 3 stars myself, or command a division of Marines, I'd rather have the division. He said, I'm not asking you. We laughed, and I said, okay, sir, if I go and I do that, I will go do this, but if I don't get 3 stars, would you consider giving me the division on the way back home? He said, yeah, but that's not going to happen. Okay. So I go to Japan, I work for this Air Force 3-star, he's my wingman, I'm his wingman, we're doing real good. I'm learning how to talk with my hands, in addition to being Italian. And we get along really, really well for 2 years. His strengths, my weaknesses, his weaknesses, my strengths, all fit really well together. He goes back to the joint staff as a 3-star. I get promoted to 3 stars, I go back to the joint staff. We serve together there. He gets promoted to the 4 stars, gets command. I keep 3 stars, I get command. Fast forward, he becomes vice chairman, and then General Dick Myers, U.S. Air Force, is nominated to be chairman. And they say to Dick, who do you want to be your vice chairman? And he says, Pete Pace. Okay? Now, truth in advertising. You give me the same choice, I'd rather have the division. Okay? Fair enough. But going to where I was told to go, doing the best I could, ended up putting me on a track that ended up with me becoming vice chairman, then chairman. Make sure people know what you want. Speak up for what you'd like to do, and then grow where you're planted. And if you get put someplace where you'd rather be doing something else, tell your boss, hey, boss, I get it. I know you need me to do this. I'm going to do it the best I can, for as long as you need me to. If it's possible, if it becomes available, I'd love to have a chance to do this over here. Make sure that people know what you want, but also let them know that you're going to do what you're told. Next, make decisions. That's why you get paid the big bucks. Make decisions. I learned this early on. I was in Vietnam. It was the Tet Offensive of 1968. We had a huge battle in Hue City. I was feeling pretty good about a month into it, thinking that I'd survived all that. And my company of about 150, 160 guys went on patrol outside of Hue City to see if there's any more NVA left. And it was pretty high grass, so we were in single file, and my platoon was given the point. So we were patrolling, and I got to a decision point, and I called back to my company commander. He's a captain, I'm a second lieutenant. He's like 24, I'm like 22. And I asked him for guidance, and he gave it to me. And we patrolled a little bit further, and I came to another decision point. And I called back and asked him for guidance, and he gave it to me. The third time I stopped and asked for guidance, if you take out the curse words, he didn't say anything to me. But I got the message, which was, hey, Lieutenant, you're out there on the point. I put you out there to make decisions. Make the decisions. I was really mad, first at him and then at myself. I gave the radio back to Corporal Irvin, my radio operator, and said, if he calls, tell him I'm not here. Because I'm going to start making decisions. And if I was going to get my butt chewed again, which I did, it was going to be for going too far, not for not making decisions. I'd much rather have a subordinate that I have to say, hold up, than for God's sake, get moving. Make decisions. If you know it's your decision to make, make it. If you know it's your boss's decision to make, get it to him or her as fast as you can. You're wasting their leadership time by keeping it at your level if it's not your decision to make. But what about the times when you're not quite sure if it's your authority or your boss's? What I recommend you do is think through what you would do. Then go to your boss and say, hey, boss, I'm not sure if this is your decision or mine. If it's my decision, this is what I'm going to do. If it's your decision, that's what I recommend you do. If you're working for me, I love you. You haven't come to me with a bird looking for you to put a worm in your mouth. You've given me a problem. You've given me a possible solution. I can then say to you, hey, it's yours, go do it. Or I got it, I will do it that way. Or I got it, let me just think about that a little bit. Either way, you've really helped me if I'm your boss. And you've done the right thing. The other thing about decisions is when you know it's your decision, but you're looking at the problem, you go, I'm not sure what the right answer is, especially when you're trying to do something about one of your troops, for example. Stand back from it a little bit and mentally put yourself in a couple of different positions. If you're that troop, what would you expect you to do? If you're one of his or her peers, what would you expect you to do? If you're one of your peers, what would you expect you to do? If you're your boss, what would you expect you to do? And then, having looked at it from all those perspectives, don't do anything that anybody expects you to do. Do what you are most comfortable doing with your personality. Think about it from everybody else's viewpoint, and then come in on, if I do this, I'm good, my heart's good. I may be right, I may be wrong, but I'm going to do it this way. You'll be right 90% of the time. If I'm your boss and you're doing those kinds of things under my leadership, I'll help you clean up the 10%. I'm happy to help you clean up the 10%. Make decisions. It won't surprise you that I admire courage. And I've seen incredible courage on the battlefield. But that's not the kind of courage I'm talking about. I'm talking about the courage that it takes in a well-lit room someplace, well air-conditioned, cups of coffee around the table, group of people together, talking about an issue. And all the heads are going up and down like this. The boss is talking, and everybody goes, oh, yeah. And somebody has the temerity to say, I see it differently, and here's why. Huge. If I'm your boss, that's what I need. I mean, put yourself in the boss's position. You're trying to make the best decision you can. If everybody's head's always going up and down, you're by yourself. You need your team to be looking at you. As a general, if I want to know how bright and smart I am, I can convince myself of shaving in the mirror. I need you to tell me my baby is ugly if my baby's ugly. Now, the more junior you are, the harder it is. You know, I'm not trying to stand up in front of a beer truck to get run over here. So, how do you get your contrary ideas on a table in a way that can be heard? If I'm working for a major and I say, hey, major, I disagree, now I set up a little testosterone problem. He's going to win 9 times out of 8 because he has to. But if I say, hey, boss, if you hadn't said that, I was thinking this. Can you educate me? If I'm right, you can say, hey, Pete, you're right. if I'm wrong, he'll give me the education I asked for. Either way, I'm helping the team. I've got my idea on the table. Maybe it's right, maybe it's wrong. You don't always have to be right, but you should always promise yourself you will never leave a conversation that without taking care of whatever that pit in your stomach is. Get it on the table. And whatever way you use. Another example could be, you know, everybody's in the same room, everybody's heads going up and down. You could say something like, A, I disagree with everybody, or B, it seems to me like everybody in this room is in agreement. I'm having a problem with this piece right here. Can somebody help me understand that better? That way people aren't defending their turf. They're able to either embrace your idea or give you the education you asked for. I still do it today. I did it all the way up through chairman. I do it in corporate life. I ask questions. Now, quite honestly, my ego is such that most of the time when I ask a question, I think I'm right. But I get the education I've asked for just enough to keep me humble. Because guess what? I'm not always right. But I always insist for myself that I get my ideas on the table. I don't need a room full of people just breathing if I'm the boss. I need a room full of people thinking critically. And especially if you're in the military, this is about lives, not about egos. Courage. Speaking truth to power. Don't have to be right. You have to speak. Next. I call it setting your moral compass. I don't know what else to call it. When I was in Vietnam, we were on patrol in July of 1968. And I had gone to Vietnam hearing all these stories about atrocities in combat. And I remember in the leadership class at Quantico standing up and saying, well, you know, I would never let myself or anybody in my command do anything illegal or immoral in combat. Not going to happen. July 1968, we're on patrol outside of Da Nang. A sniper shoots and kills my machine gun squad leader, Lance Corporal Guido Farinaro, Bethpage, New York. Great young man, born in Italy, raised in New York City, went to Chaminade High School out on Long Island. Most of his class graduated and went to college. He graduated and wanted to serve his adopted country before he went on to college. Guido was killed 30 July 1968. I was infuriated. I called in an artillery strike on the village from which the sniper fired. My platoon sergeant, who was an E5 sergeant, didn't say anything, he just looked at me. And I knew by the way he was looking at me that what I was doing was wrong. As you know, it takes a little while for a call for fire to actually get it translated to the guns to be able to put the rounds on target, thank God. I was able to call off the strike before it took place. And we did what we should have done. Swept through the village on foot, and go figure, all we found was women and children. I do not know how I could be living with myself today had I killed all those innocents. It stunned me. When we got done with that patrol, I got my platoon together and I apologized to them for almost doing that. And I promised them to the best of my ability, I would never let that happen again. Every morning since 30 July 1968, I have gotten up and said to myself, what's going to happen today? What might challenge me morally? 99.9% of the time, anything I think of does not happen. That's not the point. The point is to train yourself to think about things through a moral lens. If you have in your mind that this is the person you are this morning and it's the person you want to be tomorrow morning, same time, same place, as things happen during the course of the day, it doesn't take very long. But when somebody gives you an order to do something, you very quickly think to yourself, is this me? Can I do this? And on the very, very rare occasions where it actually is something that you're not comfortable with, then you have a mechanism to help you identify that very quickly. It just takes a second or two. Probably during the time that you're getting the order, by the time you finish receiving the order, you know whether or not you can execute it. Set your moral compass. All right, what I've learned is that you will be challenged morally when you are least prepared emotionally to deal with it. Whether it's the stress of combat, or too many drinks, or anything in between. Last 2 points before you get to your questions. One, somebody once told me that if you have integrity, that's all that matters. And if you do not have integrity, that's all that matters. And I believe that to be true. You have your name, and you have your integrity. And nobody can take those from you, but you can sure mess them up. Last, as a leader, take care of the folks in your charge. How do you do that? When you become more senior, you have a reputation. People either know you're good to your people or you're not. How do you do that when you start out? Well, whether you're starting out or whether you've been around for a long time, I recommend the same thing. Take 5 minutes a day and talk to one of your subordinates about something other than the mission. Who are they? What are their aspirations in life? Just get to know them as the human beings they are. Make sure that they start to understand that, no kidding, these are not replaceable lance corporals in some kind of machine. These are human beings. Or lance corporals in the Marine Corps, for example. If you do that day after day after day, if you defend your people without telling them you're defending them from stuff that rolls downhill, nothing, I don't care what level you are, nothing should be allowed to roll past you. Just stop it. If I'm walking around my battalion area and I see something I do not like, I can call in my sergeant major or my company commanders and tell them I don't like it. If my regimental commander is walking around my area and sees something he doesn't like, he calls me and says, hey, Pete, I don't like that. I own that one. That's my problem. I'm not going to turn around and all of a sudden start chewing on the guys below me because I got my butt chewed. The point is, stuff should not roll downhill. And if you let your folks know that you care, over time they will come to understand that about you. It takes time. It takes issues to come up. And it takes you doing the right thing to accomplish the mission, but also to take care of your people. If you become known as a caring leader, incredible things happen. In an organization that has caring leadership, the leader will put out his or her intent, and then will go to execute whatever that is. And inevitably, as soon as you start doing whatever the thing is that you're doing, whatever the mission is, there'll be the friction. In an organization that has caring leaders, the subordinates will take personal and professional risk, both physical and professional risk, and they will change your orders on the fly to get to your intent. In an organization that believes that Pete Pace is all about getting his next promotion, guess what they're going to do? Exactly what you told them to do. And because none of us is smart enough to know to see all the possible friction points, the mission fails, you get fired, your troops giggle behind your back, and they bring a new boss in. Now, the reason to take care of your troops is because that's the right thing to do as a leader. The result of being a caring leader is an organization that's going to perform way beyond the level at which any of us has a right to believe we can lead other individuals to accomplish. It's amazing. I'm absolute walking proof of trying to be a caring leader whose troops cleaned up my orders. Let me stop there and let you all have at me. Nothing's out of bounds, and if I don't know the answer, I'll make something up. Sir.
Yeah. So I think you're the senior person always sets the tone. You're the one who's given the orders. If you're in the Marine Corps or the Army, you know, at least those are the two I'm most familiar with as far as being given orders. You know, there's kind of a template you go through to make sure you don't forget to give some part of the order. But in there is the commander's intent paragraph, normally not written, normally spoken. And it's when you're telling your folks what you want to have done that you reinforce with them. Listen, this is the best thing we can think of right now. Stuff's going to start happening as we execute. Make the changes you need to on the fly to get to this objective, whatever way you feel comfortable. Very importantly, if they do that and they fail, you've got to be very careful about how you address that. If you can say, hey, thank you. You tried to do it. You took my intent and saw what was the problem and you applied a different solution to it. God bless you. If you say, I told you not to do that, I told you to do this, guess what? They're never ever gonna do anything on their own again. They're gonna be hammered back into line, which is exactly what you don't want. The senior person in the room has responsibility. I'll tell you a story about President Bush, 43. I am vice chairman. I've been vice chairman all of 1 week, October 2001. Dick Myers is on travel as chairman. I'm the acting chairman. I go to the White House. I'm sitting in the National Security Council. And there's a discussion going on, has nothing to do with the military. But I'm sitting saying, yeah. So I say, Mr. President, this is a little bit out of my lane, but that's as far as I get. He says, Pete, as long as you're in this room, nothing is out of your lane. Aye, sir. I speak my piece. 2 days later, being a Marine and a little bit of a slow learner, back to the White House, right? Next NSC meeting. Once again, there's something going on. I'm saying to myself, no, Joe Sixpack down at 7-Eleven, you didn't get to understand this. So I say, trying to, you know, I'm still, my first week as vice chairman, I'm still trying, you know, not to be a bull in a china shop. I say, Mr. President, this is a little bit out of my lane, but that's as far as I got the second time. He said, Pete, didn't I tell you 2 days ago that as long as you're in this room, nothing's out of your lane? And I said, Mr. President, you did, and you will not have to tell me that again. What did the president do? A room full of very powerful people, each who has their own cabinet position, okay, or military position. He told everybody in that room that although there were designated experts in the room in particular fields, he expected the rest of us to put our thinking caps on when that person was speaking. And what did he say to me without saying it? Pete, you got a uniform on, but I expect everybody else here in suits and dresses to be questioning what you're saying. Again, without saying it, that way I can be a better commander-in-chief, a better president. Okay? So the senior person in the room, that goes I'm a long way away from intent. But you're the one who sets the tone. And then you're the one whose reactions to failure make all the difference as far as what happens next. Okay? Did I answer it?
Yes, sir.
You have.
Is it on? General Pace.
Sir.
Thank you very much for your commentaries. Norman Fulkerson, Tradition, Family, and Property, author of An American Knight, The Life of Colonel John Ripley, A Man of Integrity. I know you know him. And that's what jumped out in your talk, sir, the importance you gave to integrity. But I want to specifically ask you, in the context of a social setting where you're having coffee and everyone is saying one thing and you disagree, but the way that you present your disagreement is in a very diplomatic way. But then you spoke of speaking truth to power, which is not a contradiction to being diplomatic. But has there been a time in your career when you saw things that were not in the best interest of the military, could even be harmful to good order in the military, where you had to say it in a less diplomatic way?
Yeah, there's one very specific point that jumps to my mind. But before I get there, let me preface it by saying, and I didn't I didn't realize this when I was on active duty. You know, after you retire, you have a chance to think a little bit. I realized after I retired that for the 4 years I was vice chairman and the 2 years I was chairman, every single time that I said to Secretary Gates or Secretary Rumsfeld or President Bush that we should not do this for these reasons, every single time it was immediately taken off the table. Which is not the same as to say that every time I made a recommendation to do something, that we did it that way. We shouldn't have. I'm the military voice, and we got lots of other ways to do things. And oh, by the way, I really don't want my course of action chosen. I'd really much rather have state or treasury or somebody else do it, if it's possible. So I set that stage because the leadership environment in which I worked was very receptive, demanding of thinking that was critical. The only time that I can remember that I got sideways with what I would have liked to have done was at a press conference. Secretary Rumsfeld and I went out for press conferences together all the time. We always had a pre-meeting before where we understood the issues of the day. And we always said to each other, you know, if you say something that's not accurate, I'll fix it. If I say something that's not accurate, you fix it. But let's make sure before we walk off that stage that the public has the correct data. So we're out there one day, and a reporter says to me, General Pace, if a U.S. soldier sees an Iraqi military person abusing an Iraqi citizen, what should he do? And I said, he should stop it. And if he can't stop it, he should report it. And Secretary Rumsfeld says, oh, what the general meant to say was da 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 da. Now, I got 3 nanoseconds. I'm either going to be okay with my boss, but I've got audiences out there. I've got the reporters who are asking the questions. I got the folks who are watching on television. I got our troops who need to have straight guidance on what they're supposed to do. I got the enemy. So in those 4 nanoseconds, I just decided to say, and I said, no, sir. I said what I meant. We hold our troops being ethical on the battlefield, and we expect them. You can look up the exact words I used. It's 10 years ago, okay? But you can look up the exact words. It's out there. After the press conference, as we always did, we had a kind of a hot wash up. Nothing was said bad about anything. I think what happened was then the secretary got back to his office and somebody called him or some people called him and said, you know, Pace kind of slam dunk it, which was not my intent. But he called me up to his office and said, I need you to go out and correct the record. And I said, about what, sir? He said, you were wrong about what the troops should do. And I said, no, sir, I was right. He said, no, you're wrong. I said, no. I said, first of all, I'm morally right. And second of all, your orders are exactly what I just told you. They are not. Yes, they are. Show me. For 3 weeks, it was bring the sec desk orders, bring this order. We got down to the field orders, looking for a seam. It was an uncomfortable 3 weeks. I mean, so I have wonderful, I mean, I have absolute respect for Secretary Rumsfeld. I thought he did the nation great service. He's a friend now. But at that moment, he was my boss, you know, but he's also a good friend. And he's been very supportive of me, both in and out of government. So I did not like being at odds with him. But it was a choice of speaking truth to power in that case, which was him, but more importantly, getting the message to the troops. Interestingly, over the course of time, I've had troops come up to me all over the planet in airports and stuff and say, you know, I heard about it, or I was watching, or whatever. And we appreciated the fact that you made it very clear to us what our responsibilities were. That's the only time I can vividly remember, you know, being at odds. Every other time, especially at that level of government, you know, if you're having to react quickly at that level of government, something's wrong. You have time to talk. So by the time you get to the White House, things have been through the one-star, two-star, three-star, four-star level before you get to the president, right? So you've had lots of time to get your ideas on the table. I was with the president hours, multiple times a week for hours at a time. I was with the Secretary of Defense hours, hours, hours every day. If I didn't get my ideas on the table, shame on me. I mean, I had nothing but time to do that. Okay. Did that answer your question, sir?
Yes, thank you.
You bet. I can't see in these lights, so wherever.
Could I add EME, Air Force ROTC, yeah. University of Maryland College Park? I have two questions. The first one is, what became of the sniper after you called him, and who made the decision? Like, for maybe punishment or whatever you did with him?
Oh, it was a enemy sniper, not a friendly sniper. Okay, we never found him.
Oh.
Yeah, this is in combat, and we had an enemy sniper kill my Marine. Okay, yeah, and I would have loved to have had a chance to find that guy. That would have been the second thing I did wrong that day. I'm sorry. I didn't really put you on the wrong track. Did that answer your question? Yeah, thanks.
Here you go, sir.
I'm hearing voices.
Cadet Hightower, United States Air Force Academy. Sir, you talked about stuff rolling downhill, but what about situations where, as a commander, you have the command responsibility, you have someone under you that messes up, and that kind of comes upward? How do you prepare against that, especially the higher in command you get?
Yeah, so I don't care who you are, where you are, what you're doing. Excuse my friends, shit's going to happen. Okay, it just is. It isn't what happens in your command. It's what you do about it. Every single person, you got command for 6 months or a year or 2 years, stuff's going to happen. It's how you handle it when it happens. Okay. I had the Marine airplane that was flying in Italy that flew underneath the cable car cables, clipped the cable, and killed 20 people. Was my plane. I was Marine Forces Atlantic, but I was also Marine Forces Europe, and I was Marine Forces South America, but I was in Norfolk, Virginia. We had sent that plane from North Carolina to Europe, and it was doing training missions, and they were flatheading, joyriding, taking pictures, and killed 20 people. I'm a three-star. Wouldn't have been any difference if I was a lieutenant. It was my responsibility. And I was the first guy in the Marine chain of command that owned the whole thing. Because I owned them as a sender from Norfolk, and I owned them as a receiver in Stuttgart, Germany. I had headquarters in both places. So I called General Wes Clark and said, sir, I'm calling you to tell you, this has happened. I've got it, and I will not talk to you again until I'm done. That freed him up to say, Pace has got it. And it freed me up to do my investigations that I had to do without influence from him. I called the Commandant of Marine Corps and told him the same thing. There's one thing to go, well, I got it. It's another thing to get it. We did a long investigation. I concluded that there was purposeful negligence. I sent them to court-martial, and they were found not guilty. But I did my part the way I should. Had I, in my own mind, done the wrong thing, you know, try to say, okay, well, you know, you guys got it, number one, or two, well, you know, they say they didn't do it, you know, you can convince yourself an easy route, but the correct route in that case was a hard route. Back down to a much lower level, if you're a squadron commander or something like that, and things will go wrong. When things go wrong, if you're my subordinate, if you come in to me and say, "Hey, boss, I kicked this one in the street," I'm good with that. If you tell me the sun was in your eyes, it was Thursday or whatever, now I got two problems. The problem we already have and the fact that I can't trust you. Own your mistakes. Own your unit's mistakes. Fix them. Be very prompt in reporting bad news and then follow up until the situation has resolved. But stuff is going to happen. And the difference between good leaders, good commanders, and not so good is how they react to the stuff that happens. Can I ask you a question? You bet. Is there somebody over here? I can't see, but if there's somebody in that blob up there, great.
Cadet Jesse Gooch, Navy JRTC, Civil Air Patrol. For our lower enlisted and non-staff NCOs, what solutions can you offer when you've seen the room with a bunch of breathers, and how can you respectively get their attention in a way you've already, in a respectful way when you've already been deemed as untrustworthy?
Let me make sure I got it right. You're a junior person in a room with a bunch of seniors, and you've got an opinion that's different than everybody else's, but you think right now we don't trust you?
Yes. Pretty much, yes, sir.
Okay. I want to answer the question. I just didn't quite follow the logic.
So when say you've been in that staff position before, and then you're deemed as untrustworthy. So next time around, you don't really have, how can you respectfully get, the command's attention when you see already that they're the people in the room just breathing, they're all in agreement.
Got it.
How can you get their attention?
Okay. First of all, thank you, please sit down. If I thought that people no longer trusted me, A, I'd be devastated. B, I could not sleep until I went and said something to somebody. I would go to my boss in that case and say, "Hey, I understand that I did this. I was wrong. I apologize. I will not let that happen again. And I understand that you're going to be in the show me mode. I'm going to prove to you over time that I can regain your trust, because I know I've lost it for these reasons." If you're in a room full of people and you know that they don't trust you, then I would say, don't ignore the elephant in the room. You can say something like, "It seems to me like everybody is in agreement. I know that my past actions had not made me the most popular guy in the room, nor the most believable guy in the room. I'm trying to fix that and will, but I'm seeing this a little bit differently right now. And here's what I'm seeing." In other words, own your responsibility. If I know that you screwed up, I'm okay. It's when I think you don't know or you haven't accepted the responsibility of your own actions that I'm not okay. So if you start out either one-on-one with me telling me what you're going to do next to fix it, or a big crowd saying, "Hey, I've kicked it in the street before, I'm working on that to regain your trust, but right now I'm seeing this, I'm listening to you better." That make sense?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
You're right.
Sir. I'm Pingo from Virginia Tech, and my question is in regards to growing where you're planted, and taking your leadership's advice on training that you might not know that you need. Is there a point, or if there is, at what point do you draw the line where you say, this is what I want, as opposed to, all right, this is what I may need, sir?
Yeah. My point was, I didn't know I needed it till after I got it, okay? Every single year, I spent 40 years active duty, plus a little bit. I didn't just go on active duty and forget. Every year, in my case, around Christmas time, I would sit down with a pad of paper, legal pad of paper, and I put down on one side reasons to get out and reasons to stay. It was actually kind of a, I already knew what the answer was, because no matter how many things I put on the get out side, there was always a part where I owed more than I could ever repay to the Marines who followed Second Lieutenant Pace in combat and sacrificed themselves for our country. I owe them then, I owe them today, I will owe them the day I die. So there was no doubt in my mind that I was going to stay active duty. So I always had that, if you want to think about it that way, I always had that, crutch is the wrong word, but when I wasn't happy with things, I would say, hey, these Marines died following your orders. Suck it up and take it on. Just do it. I'd allow myself 24 hours to bitch and moan. Don't get me wrong, it's fair. You know, when you're disappointed, you're disappointed. Grouse about it. Do what you got to do. But then strap it on like it's your own idea, okay? Now, you know, some people spend 2, 3, or 4 years. Some people spend 30, 40 years. Only you can decide. You and your family are the ones who decide how long you're going to stay. If you find, you know, that you're going from job you don't like to job you don't like, get out. You know, this is not conscription. We need 20% of our Marine Corps to stay on active duty beyond 4 years. That means we expect 80% to get out. And they're great Marines. They serve the country, they're out. They're going to be a great soldier. But whether you spend 4 years or 40 years is going to depend on how you're feeling about serving the country and the job you're doing and what you see coming up for you down the line. So it's perfectly fair to put all that in perspective and do what is correct for you. Accepting the disappointments and doing the best I could at the job I was given was correct for me, given my experience in Vietnam. It just changed me forever. Only you can decide what's right for you. But don't be afraid to, at the end of the day, say to yourself, you know, being a soldier was great, but there's other things I can do. Because guess what? We need captains of industry who used to be Army captains. Okay, I can tell you for a fact, now having been out 9 years and working with a lot of corporate boards and looking at a lot of chief executive officers, you, after 4 years in the Army, getting out as a captain, will know more about strategic planning. You're here, you want to be here by a certain time. You backwards plan from where you want to be to where you are, and you forward execute. You take that kind of idea into most companies in the United States, and people look like, whoa, where'd you think of that? We go to school as lieutenant, captain, major, lieutenant, colonel, 1-star, 2-star, 3-star. No 4-star school, sorry. Most corporations can't afford to send their guys off to school like that, because if they send Mr. Pace off to school, that desk stays open. You send Major Pace off to school, that desk is filled by another major. So we've got a system that's designed to support an education system that supports the operating forces. Business isn't that way. A long story to tell you that if you were to decide to get out, the skills you bring from your military service will serve the country well by making our economy stronger and taking care of the families in that company, whether it's 100 people or 10,000 people. Okay, I need to get off the stage because there's a big hook coming out, but thank you all very much.